السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. استومك. ذا استومك يا جماعة lies in the epigastrium and left hypochondrium. The stomach has two ends, two borders, and two surfaces. The ends of the stomach. It has two ends. Upper end called the cardia, and the lower end called the pyloric end. Pyloric end. The cardiac end lies at the junction with the esophagus, which is called the gastroesophageal junction or the cardioesophageal junction. It is called the cardia because it is the opening near the heart. Therefore, it's called the cardia. The cardiac opening or the upper end of the stomach or the cardioesophageal junction is 1 inch to the left side of the middle line. This is the skeleton and this is the costal cartilage. The middle line passing here. The cardiac opening is 1 inch to the left side at the level of the left seventh costal cartilage. Left seventh costal cartilage anteriorly and posteriorly it lies at the level of T10, thoracic vertebra number 10. The cardia is 45 centimeters from the incisors. 45 centimeters from the incisors. What is the depth of the cardia? The cardia is 10 centimeters from the anterior abdominal wall. The upper end of stomach is called the cardia because it is related and near the heart. Therefore, it's called the cardiac opening or the cardia. It lies 1 inch to the left side of the middle line at the left seventh costal cartilage, which is the same level of T10 vertebra. 10 centimeter depth from the anterior abdominal wall. Histologically, if we take histological section in the cardiac region, you will find a sphincter or not? No sphincter. What is the meaning of sphincter histologically? The layers of the GIT, mucosa, submucosa, circular muscle layer, longitudinal muscle layer. In any part of the gut, if you find thickening of circular muscle layer, this is a sphincter. The meaning of sphincter anatomically and histologically is thickening of circular muscle layer. Here, at the cardiac opening, there is no thickening of circular muscle layer. Therefore, there is no anatomical or histological sphincter. But we all know that the gastric content normally cannot pass to the esophagus. Therefore, there is a sphincter. Yes. At the cardiac opening, there is a physiological sphincter. not anatomical sphincter, no thickening of circular muscle layer, no anatomical. But there are many physiological factors acting here to form a physiological sphincter, to prevent reflux esophagitis. Reflux esophagitis meaning, the meaning is passing of gastric content to the lower part of the esophagus. This is prevented by the following physiological factors, which lead to physiological sphincter. The first factor is this angle between the esophagus and the cardia. The acute angle of the gastroesophageal junction or cardioesophageal junction. This angle is the main factor producing physiological sphincter. Why? If you lie down and the gastric content won't to return to the esophagus, these contents will press the cardioesophageal angle, occluding the lower end of the esophagus and preventing reflux esophagitis. This is the factor, main factor, which leading to physiological sphincter. The second factor is this. The mucosa at the gastroesophageal junction is very high, forming what is called mucosal rosée, like a flower. Mucosal rosée, like a flower, is very high mucosal folds. These folds are intermingled together, occluding the lower end of the esophagus. Therefore, the mucosal rosée, very high mucosal folds, like flower, intermingling, interlacing together, occluding the lower end of the esophagus. Another factor. The abdominal part of the esophagus, in the abdomen, and the pressure is high or low compared with the thoracic part. The pressure in the thorax is negative pressure. Traction on the wall of the esophagus leading to opening, tend to open the thoracic esophagus. But the pressure in the abdomen is high pressure, tend to compress the esophagus, occluding the lower end of the esophagus. Therefore, the third factor is high intra-abdominal pressure. Not like the thoracic pressure, which is negative. It is high abdominal pressure compress the lower end of the esophagus, reducing obstruction in front of any backflow from the stomach to the esophagus. Finally, the circular muscle fibers of the fundus. This part is called the fundus of the stomach. The circular muscle fibers of the fundus passing circularly, surrounding what? The lower end of the esophagus. And during contraction of these circular muscle fibers of the fundus, including the lower end of the esophagus, tend to close the cardia and the lower end of the esophagus against any backflow from the stomach to the esophagus. Therefore, all these physiological factors are responsible for the sphincteric mechanism at the cardia. All are physiological factors. Therefore, this sphincter is called physiological sphincter. Anatomically and histologically, there is no thickening of circular muscle layer. Therefore, no anatomical or histological sphincter. The cardia is the upper end of the stomach, at the junction always the esophagus. No anatomical or histological sphincter. And the physiological factors leading to the sphincteric mechanism is the acute angle between the stomach and the esophagus, forming here the cardioesophageal angle, which prevent any backflow from the stomach to the esophagus. The high mucosal folds, which are called mucosal rosae, occluding the lower end of the esophagus. The high intra-abdominal pressure compressing the lower end of the esophagus. And finally, the circular muscle layer of the fundus and the lower end of the esophagus during this contraction of these fibers tend to occlude the lower end of the esophagus and the cardia, producing a sphincter. After the upper end of the stomach, which is the cardia, here is the lower end of the stomach, which is called pyloric end, or actually pyloric sphincter. Here, if you take histological section, there will be marked thickening of circular muscle layer. Therefore, the lower end, there is an anatomical and histological sphincter called the pyloric sphincter. What is the site of pyloric sphincter? There is a plane, horizontal plane, passing by this sphincter called transpyloric plane. Plane passing through the pylorus, therefore it's called transpyloric plane. At the level of L1 vertebra. We said before that the cardia is 1 inch to the left side of the middle line. The pyloric sphincter is 1 inch to the right side of the middle line. We said before that the cardiac opening at the level of T10. The pyloric sphincter lies at the level of L1. During operation, there is a famous operation called gastrectomy. Gastro means stomach. Ectomy means excision, removal. In malignancy, in the past, in peptic ulcer, we need to excise a part of stomach or the stomach. If you want to excise the stomach, the surgeon need to cut distal to the pyloric sphincter. I find the pyloric sphincter and the cut behind to remove this stomach. The surgeon during operation identify the pyloric sphincter by what? Three factors. Number one, by inspection. If you just look, you will find a vein passing in front of the pyloric sphincter. Vein in front. In front means peri. In front of pyloric. Peri pyloric. Vein. And the scientist which describes this vein is called Mayo. There is a vein here passing in front of the pyloric sphincter called the peri pyloric vein of Mayo. Mayo. Month. Mayo. Besides the prepyloric vein of Mayo, by bulbation, bulbate the thickness of the gut. The sixth area, marked thickening, where? At the sphincter, by pyloric thickening. Also by inspection, the sphincter is always occluded, open accidentally to allow food to pass, then closed again. By inspection, the area behind is opened and the area in front is opened while the sphincter is closed. Therefore, when you look by inspection, the narrowest area, the narrow area here is in between the opened area of the gut and the open area of the gut, and in between there is a pyloric narrowing. Therefore, during operation, we identify the pyloric sphincter to cut distal to it in gastrectomy operation by pre-pyloric vein of Mayo, pyloric narrowing, and the pyloric thickening. These are the two ends of the stomach, upper end called the cardiac end, and lower end, which is called pyloric end. The stomach has two borders. Two borders. Right border and the left border. Both the right border and the left border is straight or take a curve. Curved, both are curved. Therefore, the two are called curvatures. This is curvature, this is curvature. The right border has a smaller curve. Therefore, it is called lesser curvature. While the left border has a great curvature. Therefore, it's called greater curvature. The right border is called the lesser curvature and concave, and it has a notch. This notch forming an angle. Therefore, this notch is called angular notch or incisura. Angularis. Incisura mean notch. The angular notch or incisura angularis. What is the relation of peritoneum to the lesser curvature? The peritoneum is a serous sac like the pleura. If we consider this, the peritoneum. The stomach is covered with peritoneum both anteriorly and posteriorly. To imagine your lower end of esophagus and the stomach, the esophagus and the stomach like that exactly. Lower end of esophagus, about terminal 1 inch of esophagus. And this is the lesser curvature, and this is the greater curvature. The stomach is covered with peritoneum, anteriorly and posteriorly. The peritoneum extends to the right side to form a fold of peritoneum. This fold of peritoneum is formed by extension of peritoneum from the anterior and the posterior surface of the stomach. This fold of peritoneum formed of how many layers? Two layers. Peritoneum in front and the peritoneum behind the stomach extending to the right. Therefore, it's two layers. This fold of peritoneum is called lesser omentum. Omentum means any fold of peritoneum attached to a stomach. Any fold of peritoneum attached to a stomach is called omentum or ligament. Therefore, the peritoneum extending from the lesser curvature is called lesser omentum. In comparison to this border, this is the left border of stomach, which is called the greater curvature. There is a notch. There is a notch at the cardiac end called the cardiac notch. Cardiac notch. Simply, the cardiac notch is the angle is the acute angle, which is the cardio-esophageal angle. This is called the cardiac notch or incisura cardia. The peritoneum covering the stomach, extending beyond the greater curvature in three directions. Above, left, below. This is the stomach and the peritoneum covering to the stomach anterior and the posterior. The peritoneum covering the stomach anterior and posterior extend upward to the left and down, forming three folds of peritoneum. This is the stomach, lesser curvature and the fold of peritoneum extending from the lesser curvature, which is called the lesser omentum. And this is a greater curvature. And the peritoneum in front and behind the stomach extend above to where? Above the fundus of the stomach, there is the roof of the abdomen, which separate the abdomen from the thorax. That's to say, the diaphragm. Therefore, this fold of peritoneum extending from the fundus of the stomach to the diaphragm. Therefore, this fold of peritoneum is called between the stomach, gastro, and between the diaphragm, which is pharynx. Therefore, this peritoneum is called the gastropharynx ligament or gastropharynx omentum. The same, gastropharynx ligament or gastropharynx omentum. Fold of peritoneum formed of how many layers? Two layers. Between the fundus of stomach and the under surface of the diaphragm, therefore it's called gastropharynx omentum or gastropharynx ligament. This is the extension of peritoneum from the stomach to the spleen. The peritoneum extends to the left side to the spleen, forming this fold of peritoneum between the stomach, which is gastro, and this spleen, which is called spleeno. Therefore, this fold of peritoneum is called the gastrospleenic ligament or gastrospleenic omentum. This fold of peritoneum is the largest fold of peritoneum. Descend from the greater curvature to the upper pelvis. From the stomach to the pelvis, therefore it is the greatest of all the peritoneum. Since it is the greatest of all the peritoneum, therefore it's called the greater. And as any fold attached to the stomach, it is called the greater omentum. Therefore, in comparison, when we compare the greater curvature to the lesser curvature, the lesser curvature is the right concave border of the stomach, while the greater curvature is the left convex border of the stomach, each showing an angle. The lesser curvature show incisura angularis or angular notch, while the greater curvature show the incisura cardia or cardiac notch. In both, they give the attachment to folds of peritoneum. The lesser curvature gives the attachment to lesser omentum between the stomach and the liver, while the greater curvature gives the attachment to three omenta, three ligaments: gastrophrenic abort, gastrospleenic to the left, and the greater omentum down. Okay, these are the two borders of stomach, lesser curvature and the greater curvature, beside the two ends of stomach, cardia and the pyloric sphincter. Finally, there are two surfaces for the stomach. This is the esophagus and this is the stomach. Is the stomach position like that? No. The upper end of stomach, which is the cardia, is 10 inches from the anterior abdominal wall. Therefore, it is deep. While the pyloric end, which is the lower end, it is 1 inch from the anterior abdominal wall. Therefore, the cardia is deep, while the pyloric sphincter is superficial. Therefore, the stomach is oblique in position. Therefore, it has two surfaces. This surface is anterior and in the same time superior. Therefore, this surface is called anterosuperior surface. While this surface looking posterior and inferior. Therefore, this surface is called posteroinferior surface. The stomach has two surfaces. Due to the cardia is very deep, the pyloric sphincter is relatively superficial. Therefore, the stomach is oblique. It has an anterosuperior surface and posteroinferior surface. The relation of anterosuperior surface is here. This is the anterosuperior surface of the stomach. We can divide the relation of the anterosuperior surface to three areas. Area to the left, area to the right, area below. Most of this surface lying below the costal margin. And we all know that the costal margin is lined by the septum, which separates the abdomen from the thorax, which is the diaphragm. Therefore, most of the anterosuperior surface is deep to the costal margin, and therefore it is related to the diaphragm. Most of this surface related to the diaphragm, but the liver passing from right to the left, separating here the stomach from the diaphragm. Therefore, all this part of stomach related to the diaphragm, but coming from the right side, the liver. The remaining third area is the area of stomach below the costal margin. Below the costal margin, in front of you, is the anterior abdominal wall. Therefore, the stomach related to three structures: diaphragm, liver, and anterior abdominal wall. The posteroinferior surface sleep on the posterior abdominal wall. Sleep. You sleep in what? In bed. Therefore, all these structures related to the posteroinferior surface are called the stomach bed. Posteroinferior surface related to the posterior abdominal wall and the overlying structure. These structures are called the stomach bed. What are the structures forming the stomach bed? Left crus of the diaphragm. Left crus of the diaphragm. Left suprarenal gland. If this suprarenal shore, this is left renal, left kidney. This artery to the spleen. Therefore, this tortuous artery is a splenic artery. And the spleen, the fundus lying here, above the hilum. Below the splenic artery and the spleen, this structure, which is the anterior surface of the body of pancreas. This fold of peritoneum descends from the anterior border of pancreas to this part of the gut. This part of the gut is transverse colon, part of colon passing transversely. It is a transverse colon. And it's a fold of peritoneum between the pancreas and the transverse colon. This fold of peritoneum is called transverse mesocolon. Any fold of peritoneum related to the colon is called the meso. Therefore, it is the transverse mesocolon. Therefore, the stomach bed include left crus of diaphragm, left suprarenal gland, left kidney, splenic artery and spleen, anterior surface of body of pancreas, transverse mesocolon, and the transverse colon. The posterior inferior surface of the stomach related to all these structures, which are called the stomach bed, directly or there is any separation in between. This is the stomach. If you open the anterior abdominal wall, you will find a cavity in front of the stomach, part of peritoneal cavity called greater sac. And behind the stomach, there is a cavity, very small cavity, part of peritoneal cavity called lesser sac. Therefore, the stomach is separated from all these structures by the cavity of lesser sac, which is a part of peritoneal sac. And we will know in details when we take the peritoneal cavity. Therefore, the posteroinferior surface of stomach is related to a group of structures called bed. Stomach bed. These structures are separated from the stomach by cavity of lesser sac. The stomach bed include left crus of diaphragm, left suprarenal gland, left kidney, splenic artery and spleen, anterior surface of body of pancreas, transverse meso, colon, or transverse colon. Okay? Subdivision of the stomach. The stomach is divided by two imaginary lines into three parts. The stomach is divided by two imaginary lines into three parts. The first imaginary line lying at the level of the cardia, the upper end of stomach. Imaginary line, this is the level of the cardia. And the other imaginary line extends from the lesser curvature, from this angle, which is called angular notch or incisura angularis. Vertical line extend from the angular notch to the greater curvature. These two lines dividing the stomach into the part above the cardia. The part above the cardia is called fundus of the stomach. From the level of the cardia to the level of incisura angularis, this is called the body of the stomach. The lower area below the vertical line between the incisura angularis and the greater curvature, this area is the lower area of the stomach, which is called pyloric region. The pyloric region is three parts. Wide area called pyloric antrum. Antrum يعني wide area. Pyloric antrum. هي معناها بالعربي الصالة. الصالة اللي عندك في البيت دي الانترم. Pyloric antrum. Antrum means hole. The terminal inch of the stomach is very narrow canal called pyloric canal. Finally, the stomach is ended by the pyloric sphincter. Therefore, below the vertical imaginary line between the incisura angularis and the greater curvature, there is the pyloric region, which is wide area called pyloric antrum, which means hole. Narrow area, the terminal inch is called pyloric canal, and pyloric sphincter is the end of the stomach. Pyloric canal is very narrow. Any fibrosis leading to gastric obstruction, a disease called pyloric stenosis, which is some sort of gastrointestinal obstruction. What is the arterial supply, venous drainage, and the lymphatic drainage of the stomach? Arterial supply. Stomach means the gastro. The stomach is supplied by 5 gastric arteries. 5 gastric arteries. The celiac trunk is a branch from the abdominal aorta. The celiac trunk divides to 3 main arteries. Artery passing upward to the stomach called the left gastric. Artery passing to the spleen called the splenic. And artery to the right to the liver called hepatic. The arterial supply of the stomach is derived from these arteries, celiac trunk and the 8 branches. There are 5 gastric arteries. The stomach should be supplied by gastric arteries. 2 gastric arteries on the lesser curvature and the 3 gastric arteries related to the greater curvature. The greater curvature is larger. Therefore, it has more blood supply. Therefore, it takes blood supply from 3 sites of arteries. While the lesser curvature is smaller, it takes arterial supply from 2 arteries only. On the lesser curvature, a branch from celiac trunk passing on the lesser curvature from left to right, or from right to left? From left to right. Therefore, this artery is called left gastric artery. Left gastric, passing on the lesser curvature from left to the right. Anastomose with the other artery comes from hepatic artery. A branch from hepatic artery passing on the lesser curvature from left to right or right to left? Right to left. this drawing on me like that. This is the left side at the esophagus, and this is the right side at the hepatic region, liver. Therefore, two gastric arteries, both named according to the direction on the lesser curvature. From left to right, left gastric, from right to left, right gastric, and both anastomoses together on the lesser curvature. Greater curvature, three arteries. From a splenic artery, many artery, about 3 to 5 arteries, passing to the fundus of the stomach. These arteries are very short. Therefore, these arteries are called short gastric arteries. 3 to 5 arteries, short gastric. From the splenic, descend a branch passing on the greater curvature to supply the stomach and supply the fold of peritoneum below, which is greater omentum. Therefore, this artery passing from left to right, therefore it is called left. Supplying the stomach, therefore it's called the gastro. Supplying the greater omentum, therefore it's called epibleuic. Epibleuic means supplying the greater omentum. Therefore, this artery is called left because it is passed from left to right. Gastro, supplying the stomach. And epibleuic because it supplies the greater omentum. We call this left. Why? Because the same thing is repeated by artery passing from right to the left. Therefore, it's called right. Supplying the stomach, therefore it's called gastro. And supplying the fold of peritoneum below, therefore it's called epibleuic. Therefore, this artery is called the right gastroepibleuic. Therefore, the arterial supply is the arterial supply of stomach, 5 arteries, left and right gastric on the lesser curvature, 3 arteries on the greater curvature, short gastric, left and right gastroepibleuic arteries. Venous drainage. The stomach is drained by 5 veins to the portal circulation. Portal circulation means venous drainage of the abdominal part of the GIT. Venous drainage of abdominal part of the GIT is vein called portal vein. Portal vein is formed by union of this vein from the spleen. Therefore, it's called a splenic vein. And superior mesenteric vein. Mesenteric means intestine. From the intestine, mesenteric. From mesenteric, superior mesenteric vein, a splenic vein forming the portal vein. The stomach has 5 veins. On the lesser curvature, left and right, gastric veins, which we will see it drain to portal vein. Left and right gastric veins to the portal. 3 veins on the greater curvature. 3 veins of the greater curvature, short gastric, left gastroepibleuic, right gastroepibleuic. 2 veins draining to the splenic, short gastric and the left gastroepibleuic, drain to the splenic vein. While right gastroepibleuic draining to superior mesenteric vein. Therefore, venous drainage are five veins have the same name as the arteries. The drainage is 2-2-1. Two portal, two splenic, one superior mesenteric. Two portal is left and right, gastric. Two the splenic, short, gastric, and the left gastroobliquic. One to superior mesenteric is right gastroepiblotic. Lymphatic drainage of the stomach. Sure, as usual, the relation before representing the direct spread of carcinoma of the stomach. And the lymphatic drainage, we will see representing lymphatic spread of carcinoma of the stomach. Afferent lymphatics. Afferent lymphatics communicate freely in the wall of the stomach. All these are afferent lymphatics. Anastomose freely in the gastric wall. Then, the afferent lymphatics converge toward the lesser and the greater curvature, where the lymph nodes are located on the lesser and the greater curvature, along the arteries. And these lymph nodes run along the arteries and having the same name. These lymph nodes, you suspect it's called? Left gastric lymph nodes. And this lymph node? Right gastric lymph nodes. Right gastroepiblotic lymph nodes. Left gastroepiblotic lymph nodes. Okay. Therefore, afferent lymphatics anastomose freely in the gastric wall. Then the lymphatics pass towards the curvatures where the lymph nodes are located along the arteries and bearing and having the same name. What is the details of this lymphatic drainage? The cardia. The cardia and the lower part of the esophagus drained by these lymph nodes. Called paracardial or paraesophageal lymph nodes. Paracardial or paraesophageal lymph nodes around the cardia and around the lower end of the esophagus. Draining the lower end of the esophagus and the cardia. The lesser curvature and the adjoining part of the anterior and the posterior surface. The lesser curvature itself and the adjoining anterior and posterior wall is drained by left gastric and right gastric lymph nodes. Fundus of the stomach drained to these lymph nodes. These lymph nodes between the two layers of the fold of peritoneum between the stomach and the spleen. This fold is called gastro splenic ligament. The fundus is drained by lymph node in the gastro splenic ligament and the hilum of spleen. Therefore, this lymph node is called splenic lymph nodes. From splenic lymph nodes, the lymph pass along with the arterial supply. You should remember lymphatic drainage in the body. Follow the venous drainage in all parts of the body except thorax and abdomen. Lymphatic drainage accompanying the arterial supply. Therefore, from the spleen, splenic lymph node, lymphatic spots along the splenic artery. And the lymph nodes along the splenic artery are called the spleen along the splenic artery. And in the same time, this artery above the pancreas. Therefore, these lymph nodes are called pancreatico splenic lymph nodes. Pancreatic splenic lymph nodes passing to these lymph nodes around the celiac trunk, which is called celiac lymph nodes. The greater curvature is drained by left and right gastroepiploic lymph nodes. The pyloric region is drained by pyloric region is the commonest site for malignancy in the stomach. If malignancy occurs in the pyloric region, it spread to subpyloric, retropyloric, and the suprapyloric lymph nodes. Lymph nodes below, lymph node behind, lymph node above. The pyloric region and the first part of duodenum. Therefore, it's called sub, means below, retro, suprapyloric lymph node, which pass from this lymph node to the celiac lymph nodes. All these lymph nodes drain to the celiac lymph node. Here there is important surgical and applied anatomy. In any malignancy, in any part of the stomach, the metastasis reaches the celiac lymph node. The celiac lymph node collect lymph. From where? From the stomach. Plus the umbilicus. Lymphatic drainage from the umbilicus passing in the abdomen around ligament. It's ligamentum teres. Ligamentum teres is a fibrous ligament inside a fold peritoneum between the umbilicus and the liver. This fold peritoneum is called falci form ligament. Lymphatic drainage of umbilicus passing around the ligamentum teres inside the falciform ligament to the lymph nodes in the hilum of the liver. Lymph node in the hilum of the liver, the hilum of the liver is called porta hepatis. This lymph node in the hilum of the liver drain around the hepatic artery, lymphatics around the hepatic artery, to drain into celiac lymph node. If malignant cells reach here to a celiac lymph node, malignant cells can pass and spread against the lymph flow by creeping along the wall. If the malignant cells passing along against the lymph flow, this is called retrograde spread. Creeping along the wall is called permeation. Malignancy from celiac lymph node may pass retrograde lymphatic permeation to the lymph nodes in the porta hepatis, then spread against the lymph flow in the lymphatics around ligamentum teres, around the ligamentum teres to the umbilicus, and malignant cells will proliferate in the umbilicus producing malignant nodule. The scientist which described this is whom? This nodule is discovered by a nurse in Mayo's clinic called Sister Joseph. Sister Joseph. Therefore, this malignant nodule is called Sister Joseph nodule. Sister is a nurse Joseph is sure is his wife. His wife and his husband is called Joseph. The husband is Joseph. Therefore, in America and USA, etc., the woman is called by her husband. Sister means nurse. Joseph is a wife and a husband. Joseph is the husband of this a nurse. Therefore, malignancy from the stomach or any site, and the malignant cells reach the celiac lymph node. Malignant cells pass by retrograde lymphatic permeation to the hilum of the liver. Then by retrograde lymphatic permeation to lymphatics around the ligamentum teres to the umbilicus, producing malignant nodule called Sister Joseph nodule. This is a very famous question in surgery, in inspection of the umbilicus in clinical, and we sure will say no Sister Joseph nodule, and the surgeon and the examiner ask you what is Sister Joseph nodule, how malignant cells reach here by retrograde lymphatic permeation from celiac lymph node and the lymph nodes in the porta hepatis. Another spread, the celiac lymph node, if lymph pass forward routinely, if the lymph pass forward, it pass to where? Celiac lymph node form a gastrointestinal lymph trunk, which drain to cisterna chyli. From cisterna chyli, lymph pass to thoracic duct. We have one thoracic duct or two thoracic duct? One thoracic duct. Drain here. Drain here in the root of the neck, in the brachiocephalic vein. Malignant cells may occlude this drainage. The site where the thoracic duct drain into the brachiocephalic is occluded. Therefore, malignant cells will pass against the blood flow, against the lymph flow, by retrograde lymphatic permeation to left supraclavicular lymph node, which is called the Virchow's gland. And if this occurs in any abdominal malignancy, this is called positive Torvazier sign. Finally, nerve supply of the stomach. Sure, nerve supply from the stomach is autonomic nerve supply, sympathetic and parasympathetic. Sympathetic and parasympathetic. The parasympathetic supply is two vagi, anterior vagus and the posterior vagus, both passing on the lesser curvature. The anterior vagus gives the hepatic branch, supplying the liver and the gallbladder, which is motor and secretory. Parasympathetic supply to all GIT is motor and secretory. Hepatic branch is motor and secretory, it is a gallbladder. Posterior vagus gives celiac branch. Celiac means intestine, supplying the intestine to the junction between the right 2/3 and the left 1/3 of transverse colon. Celiac branch supplying all intestine to the junction between right 2/3 and the left 1/3 of transverse colon. Sure, celiac trunk is motor and secretory to the intestine. The two vagi, after giving hepatic and celiac branches, gives the gastric branches to the fundus and the body of stomach. These gastric branches, the fundus and the body of stomach, sure, motor and the secretory to HCL. H vagus end as pyloric branch. Pyloric branch, which is called the nerve of latar J. The nerve of latar J, which is the pyloric branch, is responsible about what? Motor to the pyloric antrum and the canal. while relaxing the sphincter. Motor to the antrum and the baroic canal and relax the sphincter. This produce what? Evacuation of the stomach. Contraction to the pyloric antrum and the canal. Relax the sphincter. Therefore the stomach empty by this nerve of lethargy. In peptic ulcer disease, in duodenal peptic ulcer, there is very high hyperacidity. Therefore, maybe one of the solution to this problem is to denervate the stomach, cutting the vagus. Cutting the vagus to denervate the stomach to reduce the production of HCl. Cutting the vagus to denervate the stomach is called the vagotomy. Vagotomy operation means division of the two vagi to denervate the fundus and the body of stomach, leading to lowering of the acidity and the healing of the ulcer in this patient. Okay. The parasympathetic supply is motor and secretory, while sympathetic supply from greater splenic nerve is sympathetic, come to the stomach with the arteries. Sympathetic runs by plexus around the arteries to the stomach, which is reverse of parasympathetic. It is inhibitory to motility and the inhibitory to secretion. Okay, this is arterial supply, venous drainage, lymphatic drainage, and the nerve supply of the stomach. Finally, there is one thing I should add to the sphincteric physiological mechanisms at the cardia. The sphincteric mechanism at the cardia, we say that the sphincteric mechanism depends on number one, acute cardioesophageal angle, high mucosal fold, which is called mucosal rosée, the circular muscle layer of the fundus occludes the lower end of the esophagus, the high abdominal pressure. Okay, and we add one thing, the esophageal opening in the diaphragm is 1 inch to the left side of the middle line. The esophageal opening in the diaphragm, 1 inch to the left side of the middle line. Therefore, the esophagus pass in the fibers of the left cross of the diaphragm or the right cross of the diaphragm? This is the esophageal opening in the diaphragm. And these are the fibers of the right cross. And these are the fibers of the left cross. The esophageal opening in the diaphragm is 1 inch to the left side of the middle line. And there is a very famous thing occur here. Fibers from right cross of the diaphragm pass to the left side, surround the esophagus, and return again. Although the opening in the diaphragm is 1 inch to the left side of the middle line, the esophageal opening in the fibers of the right cross of the diaphragm. What? Continuous contraction of these fibers during respiration will act like a squeezing factor outside the esophagus, maintaining the lower end of the esophagus closed, preventing any backflow of gastric content to the lower part of the esophagus. Therefore, sphincteric mechanisms at the cardia depends upon many factors. The most important factors are two: the acute angle at the gastroesophageal junction and this factor, the esophagus passing in the fibers of the right crest of the diaphragm. Therefore, continuous contraction of these fibers compress the lower end of the esophagus, prevent reflux esophagitis. Okay?